I welcome everyone's attention to this video. Attention is all important. It is essential that we realize what succeeds on the spiritual path to non-dual realization actually is familiarity. Familiarity is the key. I call it evaporating the continuity fear. Evaporating the continuity fear, moving our comfort zone, familiarity is what succeeds. This is why the present world culture should be so completely condemned, actually, because we're turning it into a belief in a product, that there's some way we can buy non-duality. We think non-duality needs to be put into a product, so we want some Thomas Edison to be out there inventing, you know, the light bulb, so that we can go buy non-duality as a thing, as a product, as something, and we're consumers, and we're waiting for that, you know, the new next great thing, the next great innovation. Non-duality is a product. It will never happen. That will never happen. It's entirely a question of familiarity. So how, where you place your attention, and how, is all important, and it has to be something that is continually worked at. In order to get more and more and more and more and more comfortable with it. Okay, now, for example, about 10 months ago, I purchased this book, Spaciousness, the Radical Dzogchen of the Vajra Heart, translated by Keith Dalman. It's the teachings of Longchenpa, a great Radical Dzogchen, Tibetan Buddhist, realizer of non-dual truth, 10 months ago, and I could barely get through, you know, little bits and pieces, and I was just like, wow, this is just incredible. And 10 months later, I was able to read the entire book through in one sitting, about 2 hours straight, and really wasn't strained, and felt tremendous transmission from it. And I'm convinced that Longchenpa knows the truth and is compassionately sharing it with us. It's all there. It's all there. And I just felt this tremendous transmission. Wonderful. Why? How is that possible? Well, 10 months of all-out effort of attention to non-duality, to focusing and trying to get the attention where it needs to be. Just relentless, everyday effort. Now, what kind of culture supports that? Do we have a cultural support for that? No, we don't. In my situation, it's sort of unique to my situation. It's not really a cultural thing at all, but it makes it quite difficult. I live in a place which doesn't value this at all, and so I have to do it like, oh, you know, almost in secret, like I'm in a cave or something. But still, this is what succeeds. This is what succeeds. To be able to appreciate this teachings of Longchenpa, to really appreciate it, and say, you know what? He's absolutely right, absolutely true. This is fantastic, wonderful. This is the result of just relentless effort to keep moving a comfort zone. Keep moving your comfort zone through. And how you do that? Daily efforts. There's no other way. There is no other way. It can never be a product you go into a store and buy, and we have been brainwashed, or we brainwash ourselves into this delusion. For instance, yesterday when I was reading the Longchenpa book, and the start of the football season was underway, and the 49ers are playing, and everybody's watching it. It's just like a really huge, big event. Now, I paid no attention to it whatsoever. Had to choose. Of course, I would have liked to watch a game. Not really, I mean, but it's the thing to do. I used to do that. And I said, you know what? We have to try everything we possibly can try right now. Give it all we've got right now. 13th anniversary of September 11th, 9/11 is coming up, 13th anniversary. Don't think that the world is it's becoming peaceful. It is not. So there's an example. There's an example. You make choices. I've had choices since the day that I was born. I heard voices that told me right from wrong. If I had listened, I wouldn't be here today, living and dying with the choices I've made. George Jones song. Very true, very true. We have choices all the time. Now, if you're watching this video, you're making choices, making the choice. Put your attention, be inspired, pep talk, saying, hey, I have to keep on keeping on, bringing my attention to the highest teachings I can, and keep on bringing it there and keep working on it. Don't stop. Don't stop. This is the advice of the great non-dual knower, Sri Sri Anandamaya Maz. You must keep your momentum going on the path. You must be a daily effort. You have to surround yourself with saintly books, saintly people, everything you can do to keep on moving your comfort zone closer and closer and closer to the realization. Non-dual realization. It's a familiarity thing. And the continuity fear is what is the break that is keeps us going slowly, and we have to acknowledge this, otherwise we'll give up. We'll say, oh, I'm just not cut out for this. I can't turn it into a product. I can't seem to objectify it. You cannot objectify it. It's never a product to purchase. It's never a product to purchase. So you must realize that you have this underlying continuity fear. It's the only problem all of us have. And that will make it seem like frustratingly slow. I just see it. I can't quite get it. It's an ordeal. Spiritual path is an ordeal. Don't let anyone tell you otherwise. Of course, those who want to market it as a thing come to my seminar, expensive seminar. They're marketing it as a commodity. Okay, and people are willing to pay huge amounts of money if they can just, someone will tell them, yeah, you know what? You can. It's easy. You just take my seminar, and you can get it like that. They will pay, because that fits right into the materialistic mindset, the dualistic mindset of objectification, of commoditization, and that it's something we can buy, we can purchase if we just work hard enough at keeping our attention on the belief in process, time, space, process, form, and manipulating these so-called forces that we believe, which really don't exist. In other words, keep our mind on triumphing, actually. Duality that you can then be one of the fortunate ones, be able to purchase happiness, non-dual realization happiness. This is deception. This is deception. That's not how it's going to happen for anybody. Okay, so you and I and everybody else, those of us who are slaving away every day, putting our attention, trying to get clearer and clearer and clearer and clearer and clearer. One day, and it won't be long, we're the ones who are going to be liberated from this dualistic delusion. We are the ones who are going to be liberated. Okay. And the ones who have made all their large amounts of money, and they think that they're going to be able to purchase it somehow, are the ones who are still going to be floundering in hell. Floundering in the hell of duality. This is a fact. This is a fact. Now, of course, it may seem that we're the ones floundering now. You know, we don't have the money, we don't have the health, we don't have all the stuff that seems to make life convenient. What we call life is really an attempt to triumph over life, which is why we have death, because how can you triumph? How can you prove triumph unless you've triumphed over something? Okay, that's a severe adversary, right? So here we are in what we call life, clinging to this existence, this body, which is threatened on all sides by death, and so we can feel like, you know what, we're greater than God. God's not triumphing over anything, but we are. We're triumphing over death. We made death, okay? This is part of duality. So we seem to be having all this trouble, and yet our comfort zone is like, you know, I'm able to read Longchenpa, the entire book, 13 Cantos, and feel very comfortable with it. I feel very accepting of it, and feeling like, wow, this is food for the spirit. You know, this is spiritual food. and eat the food and digest it. No problem at all. I woke up this morning and I just had incredible clarity about duality. And I just said, wow, this is fantastic. You eat the spiritual food and you digest it, and you develop more and more capacity as you go along like that, so you can eat more and more quantities and get more and more nourishment, spiritual nourishment. This is how it works. This is the game. This is the way. There isn't any other way. So obviously the right culture is that which supports the non-objectification, non-commoditization of non-dual realization of the spiritual path. And the wrong way is the present modality in the world. That is most certainly the wrong way. One moment. So every moment our attention is somewhere. Every moment our attention is somewhere. And it's super, super important that it be on moving our comfort zone towards non-dual realization. There is non-dual realization. I am absolutely convinced that Longchenpa experienced this and abides in it. Absolutely convinced. Jesus Christ also absolutely convinced. Sri Nanda absolutely convinced. And we can do it too. Absolutely convinced of this. And we have to do it. There's no choice. We have to do it. So we have to do it, and we can do it. And we must watch our attention. And every moment that passes, our attention is somewhere. And if it's not on getting familiar with non-dual realization, then it's on duality, strengthening our delusion, really. And of course, as you strengthen your delusion, the underlying message is, don't worry, we'll come up with a product for you to make you happy. No, they won't. No, they won't. No, they won't. Happiness is never a product. It will never be turned into an objective product, ever. Okay, so this whole push towards science and materiality and objectification and products, commodities, all stuff, it's all much ado about nothing. Much ado about nothing. And is simply a distraction for your attention, an excuse, because of the continuity fear. In a wise culture, again, people spend the time and attention on quiet sitting, full stop in the burn, no action. I can do no action. I cannot triumph. I cannot make things better. I cannot do anything. I'm not choosing among illusions. See, in duality, what we're doing is we're choosing among illusions. And the non-dual realization is all illusions are really, as Longchenpa would say, and I'll just say, it's unspeakable in terms of, it. But full stop in the burn means you're not active trying to choose between illusions. Like, how do I live? How do I defeat death? How do I defeat darkness? How do I defeat sickness? How do I defeat, No, we're not choosing either life or death, light or darkness. The light that we're seeing is an imaginary light, so that it can be contrasted with imaginary darkness, okay? We want to outshine God. This is our sin, the sin of pride, spiritual pride, the Luciferian sin, is wanting to be greater light than God. But God is the clear light. The clear light, absolute clear light. What we're trying to do is we're trying to outshine what? How do we outshine that? We can't. So what we do is we create this duality of imaginary light and imaginary darkness. And the darkness has to be there so that the light can be contrasted, the imaginary light can be contrasted with imaginary darkness. Okay. So it seems, and we think, see, this is shining brighter than the darkness. See, we've outshone the darkness. We're outshining the darkness. Same thing with life and death, both imaginary categories, actually. We want to say that we are able to survive, and defeat death through our life. We're defeating death. Of course, death has to be there in order to be triumphed over. Darkness has to be there in order for light to say that it's brighter. See, lights, our imaginary light, we're saying, wow, look how much brighter this light is than this pitch darkness. And then we're thinking, you see, God, look how much brighter we are, how much more light we are, you see? That gives us this feeling that we're triumphing, we're being more than, better than, greater than, we have greater light. But it requires this belief in darkness in order for us to believe that this light is greater, how much greater it is. Same thing with death and life, same thing with lies and truth. See, it's all this is dualistic. We're living in this dualistic contrast. We're contrasting and then claiming that this proves something, we've been able to triumph over something. We really want to triumph over God, but we can't. We can't. It's the clear light. It's the clear light. It's the clear light. And this is what Longchenpa brings up and emphasizes over and over and over and over and over and over again. And it sinks in. You start to get it and you say, wow, I feel like, yeah, I understand this. I understand this. Holy cow. And so when we're choosing between light and darkness, we're deluded. Choose neither. Choose neither. Choose neither. Choiceless awareness is the ground of being, is the pure awareness. Pure awareness is choiceless awareness. It doesn't need to choose. God doesn't need to choose. Everything is all-inclusive. Everything is resting effortlessly on the perfect, pure ground of pure spaciousness. There is no an appearance of what we call darkness, an appearance of what we call light. God is not contrasting those. We're doing it. We're making these appearances to contrast, to claim that we're triumphing over something, that we're vastly better than something. That's why we have good and bad. Same thing with good and bad. All this relativism, this duality, it's self-deception. It's spiritual pride, actually. And we've been caught up in this for so long that we have a continuity problem, we're afraid, but that can be evaporated, and we have to. So the more our culture supports turning our attention to this issue, and quiet, silent sitting where you're committed to not doing anything is the very fastest way, actually. You're going to feel the burn. You're going to feel like, what am I doing? I've got to think. I've got to succeed. I've got to triumph. I've got to defeat something. I have to elevate something, right? And you're not doing anything. You're just sitting here quietly. And so you're going to feel this consternation of activity. You want action. You want success. Okay, all of that is delusion. All of that is delusion. And so you continue just to sit quietly and you just feel this consternation. That's called full stop in the burn. Full stop in the burn. This is what, if you want to fast track yourself, that's what's going to work. But it's not going to happen just because you do it once. It's a daily effort on your part, is to continuously, if you want to call it mindfulness training, that's part of it. Where is your attention? But your attention has to be such that you're feeling this, I can't go, I'm not choosing to go forward, I'm not choosing to stay where I am, I'm not choosing to go backward, you know, I'm not choosing to go sideways, and it's just like, the result of that, I can testify to this, starting out just 10 months ago with this book, this transmission from Longchenpa, which was just astonishing to me. And 10 months later, I'm able to go through it like a knife through butter, and I'm just saying, wow, this is beautiful, this is fantastic, I love this, this is just talking, you're preaching on the choir here, you know. It's like that. 10 months, okay? So, yeah, 10 months of an ordeal. But if I hadn't done that, where would I be, floundering the same as before or worse? And so it avails us nothing to not make the effort. You know, avoiding the ordeal doesn't help us at all. Doesn't help us at all. Doesn't help us at all. So the more people speak up like this, the better it is for a culture, for a society, for a world. You need many, many, many people being adamant, not just one, because that's the commoditization is a monopolization. Anytime the business mindset, the dualistic mindset of let's monopolize. It's not just business, it's the dualistic mindset. Let's monopolize this and show how much greater it is, contrast, how much greater it is. You want to come up with just one person, one voice, one, you know, just so it can be. It's better to have many, 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 many people speaking up adamantly, that you develop a culture that way, where people feel supported and say, this is the right thing to do. That putting myself through this daily ordeal is the right way to use my time. For sure it is. That's why there's a lot of success in Tibet throughout the years. A lot of people spent time living in caves. Longchenpa spent most of his time living in a cave by himself, not doing anything. And this is just full burn, you know, full stop in the burn, totally. And it was the right thing to do culturally. It was the respected thing to do culturally. And so it was not a materialistic culture. They're just, you know, enough to survive, and then you're supposed to put your attention on liberation from delusion. So a lot of people there, a lot of spirits there, spent time in isolation, in not doing anything, just feeling this burn. You know, we feel this burn in this world if we're not keeping up with technology. We feel this, like we're falling behind, all this kind of stuff, right? It's just like, it's like just very difficult. Wow, I'm just nobody, getting nowhere like that. And just, sit there quietly with that this inner angst, and just say, oh, you know, I'm failing to succeed, and it's all dualistic delusion. And we may not understand what do we mean by duality. It's taken me a lifetime to get more and more appreciation for it. But when in a culture that supports this and has faith that it's doable, then you feel like, you know what, even though I'm struggling, that's okay. I still have, just like people get sent to school now, they may struggle in school, but everybody's going to school, so they figure, well, I just better keep working at it, I can't afford to fail. In a spiritual culture, same kind of situation. And you get, then many of us realize non-dualization, and people know about it, and they say, well, it's very doable, and I need to spend more time focusing on this. And non-dualization is the same. Doesn't matter what tradition you're in. I can understand a Christian non-dual. I can understand a Buddhist non-dual, a Hindu non-dual, and an Islamic non-dual. Whatever religion, those who are speaking from the non-dual standpoint, I can understand it. I can appreciate it. And see, they're all talking about the exact same situation, actually. And the discipline of silent sitting is something that translates through all traditions. And more precisely, the full stop and the burn. The full stop and the burn is something that translates as you sit silently, as you're committed to putting your attention on liberation from the delusion of duality. You're going to feel this burn, and you relax into it. You don't fight it. You accept it. You bless it. You say thank it. It's the breaks. Yesterday, I had an amazing experience in church. We were in church, and someone came in right behind in the pew right behind us. And it was this very odd person, to say the least. I could feel the vibes. It was like, wow, what is this? Is this death? What is this? And it was this lady, all dressed in like super saturated black, dark. Her features had this feeling of darkness. She had this overall feeling of death and darkness. Very incredible. Like it was a manifestation of death, actually. And wearing a military camouflage hat in church. You're not supposed to wear hats in church. This is someone who was out there, really out there. And when we came the time to say peace unto you, and I turned around and she stuck out her hand and I shook her hand and we said, peace unto you. And I wasn't afraid. I wasn't afraid of this person, but I was aware that this person was emanating a very dark, strange vibe for sure. But I didn't feel shaky or frightened or paranoid or anything. I was just aware of it, okay. And she stuck out her hand and I shook her hand and it was bony and icy and, you know, just like a skeleton shaking hands with death. It's like shaking hands with death. And I shook hands with death, said, yeah, peace be unto you. And she said, peace be unto you. And like this, I wondered, this is very profound. And this morning I understood it because the whole dualistic clarity about dualism came to light. And we need death to so we can play the game of triumphing over it and having a greater life than God. See, the way we try to be greater than God is to triumph over something. So we're the ones who've imagined death so that we can triumph over it. And we need to forgive death and say, peace be unto you, death. Actually, it was my spiritual pride. It was life. It was my desire to triumph that had me imagine death. Same with darkness. The same with darkness. It's not like darkness is there and we need to triumph for it. It's that our desire to triumph, to shine brighter than God, requires us to have some foil, which is darkness. It's not darkness's fault. It's not evil's fault. It's not death's fault. Not at all. Not at all. We're the ones who are just using darkness, this idea, notion of darkness, death, evil, ignorance, confusion, chaos, all this, so that we can seem to be superior by contrast to it, you see. So in shaking death's hand yesterday, I didn't feel greater or lesser. It meant on level terms there in the church. Level terms. You're required to in church. Everyone shakes, you know, you shake your hand of everyone around you and say, peace be unto you, peace be unto you. Doesn't matter who they are. So I shook hands with death, saying, peace be unto you. And she said, peace be unto you. I believe she did. I think so. Yeah. And this was a realization. This was a realization that these so-called opposites or polarities of it can be seen what it's all about. Now, it's not so much resolving the polarity or something. You can look at it that way, or that can also be a confusion. So let's not struggle with it. What's important is to realize the game that we've been playing. Because the darkness is not really darkness, and the light that we're imagining is not really light. And the evil is not really evil, and the good is not really good. And the chaos is not really chaos, and the organization is not really organization. Everything we're attaching meaning where it doesn't really exist, attributes where it doesn't exist, association where it doesn't exist, in order to try and provide contrast. In order by contrast, but in God there is no contrast at all. All is one. All is one. All is one. So we have these great realizers of the past, and right now we're wondering, okay, is it possible now in these circumstances to realize? Yes, I believe it is. Through relentless practice, attention, a relentless effort, especially sitting quietly. And not doing, not choosing, don't choose, Don't choose between death and life. This is what I'm saying. Don't resolve the polarities, like make them one or try to. That's a way of talking about that could be accurate, depending on what the teacher is getting at or not, okay? Or it could be inaccurate. Don't choose. Don't choose between light and darkness. Don't make any choice at all. This is what brings the burn. And so just full stop in the burn. It's not like we integrate the darkness into the light. We don't integrate death into life. That is duality. That is duality. We simply practice abiding as choiceless awareness. Because we made these categories in order for the purpose of contrast, in order to try and prove that it's possible to be greater than God. We are one with God. The idea of being greater than has to be towards God. There isn't anything else it could be towards to. So when we are choosing, contrasting, we are trying to be greater than God. There's no question about this. So when we sit in this choiceless awareness, is there turmoil? Yes, absolutely. The mind is ricocheting, like, what can I choose? I need to choose something. No, choiceless awareness. This is the message of the adepts, that we think we're falling to an abyss. No, absolutely not. Longchenpa made it very clear that the Buddha mind, the Christ mind, the ground of being, the clear light, is its own meaning. It generates its own meaning effortlessly. The meaning is there. The spontaneity is there. It's inherent meaning. It's not something that needs to be chosen. And Longchenpa says, the fear is that if we don't choose, we'll be in an abyss. That is not so. He says, it's absolutely not so. So we have to, put faith in that. Christianity, it's called pick up your cross. You must carry your cross. If you know you're lost, pick up your cross. Do you know you're lost? Jesus saves today. The cross is the burden of this ordeal, of the spiritual path, the ordeal, the spiritual path. Jesus showed life and death. What we call life and death are just a contrast. Meaningless contrast, actually. We do not have to choose between them. We do not have to choose between anything. Choiceless awareness is our true nature, is the true nature of all reality. There is nothing that is being contrasted in reality. Reality is not a play in contrasts. Reality is all oneness, all inclusiveness, one family, no contrast there. We have ugliness and beautiness. We have all these contrasts. That's called duality. Duality is contrast. Light and dark. Ugliness, beautiness, beauty, all of this. The way to be free is to practice this choiceless awareness. Stop trying to manipulate. Stop trying to change things. Stop trying to choose. Spend time getting used to this. And of course, it is a strain. It's the feeling of right now, of course, it's a strain. And you think all these people are out making all this money so they can buy some anti-strain pill. No way. They will have to go through this ordeal too, and there's no pill at all that is going to take away this strain, this ordeal. It will always be an ordeal. Spiritual path will always be an ordeal. So if you've been putting yourself through this ordeal, congratulations, continue. That's what works. Yeah, pity on those who are pursuing pills from, you know, pharmaceutical companies, pharmaceutical, in terms of sparing them from this ordeal. There's no way you can be spared from it. And those who tell you can are doing you a great disservice. The real teachers, I'll name the big three that I pay so much attention to, Jesus Christ, Sri Sri Nandamaya Ma Longchenpa, they make it very clear that it's an ordeal. And as an ordeal, you must put yourself through. They don't spare you this advice. They don't spare you. Thank God for that. Christianity has always been you pick up your cross. You must carry your cross. The burden, the cross is heavy. It's a heavy burden. They said, hey, Jesus, why don't you choose life? Why do you choose life? And he said, I choose neither life nor death. I'm in choiceless awareness. You do whatever you want to. Those are your choices, not mine. I don't make choices. All is one. I'm not the body. I'm not a commodity. I'm not a thing. I'm not an appearance. Appearances are arising. But I am not, I am is not an appearance. It's the oneness. It's awareness of the oneness. The contrast freeness. That is the true life. That is the true light. Not imaginary light contrasted with imaginary darkness. In reality, there's neither light nor darkness in terms of what we are used to. There's the pure, pure, clear light. And appearances within that, but the appearances are only appearances. They leave no residue. They leave no residue in the arising and subsiding. There is no residue ever whatsoever. None. Purity remains entirely pure. When the darkness or appearance of darkness arises and subsides, there is zero residue. When the appearance of light arises and subsides, there is zero residue. It is traceless. It is absolutely traceless. Completely traceless. So, this is conveyed, Longchenpa conveys this to an astonishing extent. Supremely helpful. Now, we're putting the foot on the gas, taking the foot off the brake as much as possible now, because we're going into a time of great spiritual pride on this planet. And great spiritual pride automatically attracts the contrast. It's opposite the contrast. It was like that lady in church was the goddess of destructivity, which I've told you about, which is the contrast. When you want to bring peace, you must have the contrast of war. When you want to bring light, you must have the contrast of darkness. You see, when you want to bring harmony, you must bring the contrast of chaos. So the dark side shows up big time. And what happened in church was that I shook hands on the level. You see, and there was peace between us. There was peace between us. Because there's an inner realization, wow, I dreamed both of these up. Neither one are true. I'm not trying to put one above the other. Do not try to put one above the other. This is the mistake. This is the mistake. They both arise and subside tracelessly with no residue in the one boundless pure spaciousness of the clear light without crystallizing at all. Okay. Appearances do not bring about any crystallization whatsoever in pure spaciousness. And so you don't have to choose which one you want. Let them both subside equally. Arise and subside as they like. It has no effect, does not change reality in the slightest bit. There's no preference for whatever rises or subsides. It's all spontaneous. Now, these are just words, but the words, it's appreciated. What it's pointing to is appreciated. So, previously, I wasn't this aware. So when I saw the goddess of destructivity come into this world, which I did, I sort of harassed her, I said, hey, have you changed your ways? As if it was up to her to change her ways, right? And I was a mistake. I should have said, peace be unto you, peace be unto you, peace be unto you, in a choiceless way of not higher, not lower. We're not contrasting here. A no contrast attitude, which is called love, actually. A loving attitude, peace be unto you. And that would have been very different, you see. She probably would have stopped and turned and said, peace be unto you. And then gone on her way to, provide the contrast. Remember, we called her into the world, goddess of destructivity, because of our pride. Our pride has called her into the world, the goddess of destructivity. But there is no conflict. I have no conflict with her now. Peace, peace, peace. And you wonder why in historically sacred places, etc., conflict would rage and nothing would happen to these places somehow, because non-duality resides there, and there is no need to call upon contrast in those places. You do not need to change darkness into light, nor light into darkness. You need not do anything except step back into this choiceless awareness, the non-dual position. Shift your attention to the pure spaciousness of the non-dual non-duality, and just simply abide there. Again, we have called it into this world, the troubles, so that we may seem to triumph over them, to contrast against them. We have called the darkness here in order to seem to battle against it and get this feeling of progress. And then hopefully we think to triumph over and defeat it and to show how much greater we are. You see, greater than, the desire to be greater than. Again, there's only God, so the desire to be greater than has to be a desire to be greater than God. But we can relinquish this desire. The continuity fear stands in is the brakes that make us frightened of this, but we evaporate this gradually. So the only way to succeed is your daily effort, is your daily effort. And that is something I can say I've done my entire life, is every single day, daily effort. Every day is dedicated towards doing the best I can to try and understand, why am I suffering? Why is there suffering? Why is there misery? Why is there death? Why is there sickness? Why? Now I know. For the purpose of contrast, for the purpose of trying to prove we're greater than God. That's why. But it's the daily effort, it's your suffering, it's your friend. You say, wow, I'm suffering, why am I suffering? You know, but my suffering was so terrible, I had to pay attention. Why am I suffering? Well, why? And just, it's still there, so I gotta keep asking and keep trying and keep trying. I just read everything I could read, studied everything. Just keep trying. Why am I suffering so bad? Wow, this is horrible. What's going on like that? Of course, the greater triumph you want to achieve, the more adversary you bring to yourself, the more suffering you bring to yourself. So you want to triumph over suffering too, you see? That's why the suffering's there. In choiceless awareness, there's neither suffering nor non-suffering. Those are dualistic categories. There's neither happiness nor non-happiness, actually. This is a way of using words, concepts, to move us towards the feeling and flavor of it. Yesterday I read Longchenpa, the book, and today I won't leave you without some words from Journey Beyond Words. I'm going to at least try this. These are the words of Jesus as transmitted to Dr. Brent Haskell. And I will read the introduction. I will start off and just try reading the introduction. Let me put on my reading glasses one moment. All right, we'll just wing it. Introduction. Greetings, I am Yeshua. I have come to discuss with you A Course in Miracles. Even as you begin, be aware that it is possible for you to be misled by its name. In your world, when you hear the word course, you think of learning, but you are not here to learn. You are here to experience. And you will find with great joy that there is a dramatic difference between the two. Learning is nothing more than a process undertaken by your brain, but experience goes beyond the learning of your brain. It goes beyond your thinking, beyond your analyzing, to the very core of your being, wherein lies the true nature of what you are, which is the Son of God. Hear me well. If you undertake this course as an exercise in academic learning, as the study of ideas to be mastered, you will fail. And in your failing, you will miss this course and its miracles entirely. Your entry into this course is your choice to experience, to live, and to become. The purpose of this course is absolute peace. Within peace, there is the total absence of conflict. Within peace, there is never doubt, only total certainty. Within peace, there is never questioning. Because there is never questioning, there is never fear. And because there is never fear, there is only room for love. Love is freedom, nothing more. To the extent that you allow freedom to your brother, you shall receive in the exact same measure freedom, which is love. If you, in your thinking, would restrict your brother, thus to deny him freedom, thus to deny him love, then you must deny yourself that self-same freedom and love. In the absence of your freedom, in the absence of love, you will experience conflict. You will not be at peace. Again, I tell you, this course is nothing more than a pathway which shall lead you to the experience of total peace. Such peace is not something you can think about. not something you can debate. Indeed, if you ever find yourself wondering whether you are at peace, I promise you, you are not. As you approach the daily lessons, the first two-thirds, as I have told you, are for the purpose of breaking down, if you will, the ghosts you bring with you. These ghosts, beloved masters of your lives, are the thinking, the concepts, the thoughts, the patterns of behavior generated from within your mind, which imprison you in this world of illusion and keep you from the peace of which I speak. So bear in mind, we are not trying to take anything away from you, rather to help you dissolve barriers to the state of peace. As we help you to break down these walls, you will realize, first in thoughts, but then, and this is the essence, you shall experience the truth we bring. You will experience it with knowing and certainty, at the deepest level of your being, far beyond the thoughts themselves. In the knowing, in the certainty, in the experiencing, the barriers will truly dissolve, and you shall be free. You are here to learn to live, not to learn to think. Indeed, you will discover with great rejoicing that your thinking, in great measure, is what keeps you from being truly alive. Ponder for a moment your idea of anything. That idea, that thought, is but an interpretation. It is a choice you make, a choice which defines for you that which you seem to be experiencing. I have come to tell you, and hear this well, that what you perceive, what you interpret, which is based upon your thoughts, has nothing whatsoever to do with reality. This is a description of the major barrier which separates you from your peace. In order for you to have a thought about something, it is absolutely essential that the thought be preceded by an experience. Without the experience itself, the thought could not be born. So it is that your thoughts are always interpretations, based not upon this moment, but upon experiences you have had in what you call the past. Love is freedom. Recall those words. Say them over and over and over again, until the day comes when you shall experience them as your reality. Every thought, every opinion, every interpretation which enters your mind is based upon what you perceive as the past. Therefore, when you perceive anything, what you are doing is saying, I am choosing to demand, insofar as I am able, that this entity, this aspect of creation, which by its nature exists in a state of freedom, I am choosing to demand that this being not be free. For when you, in your thinking, choose to interpret based upon the past what another being is, and then believe that interpretation to be reality, you have made yourself the enemy of that being's freedom. For you are saying, I choose to demand for my purposes that you be as you were, indeed not even as you were, but as I perceived you were, and now this moment you do not exist. For you are, I tell you, what you were. Do you see that this is the absence of love and the absence of freedom? And if you wanted to be vicious, you could even call it hatred. Hear me well. When you form an opinion of any aspect of creation, including yourself, it is but your wish to rob the universe and yourself of freedom and therefore of love. Thus, A Course in Miracles says, I see only the past, and I am never upset for the reason I think. deep within you, there is total peace. There is the absence of conflict. There is a wellspring of complete freedom, which is love, and which must be synonymous with vibrant joy. That is your right. That is your inheritance as the Son of God, and nothing can take it away from you. In your thinking, you can choose to imagine that you do not have it, which is exactly what you have done. Thus, the purpose of all the initial lessons is to help you to experience the realization that the absence of peace, the presence of conflict, the absence of love, the absence of freedom, all stem only from your imagination and ultimately from your thinking, which must be of the past, and which is your desire to deny freedom to the entire universe and to yourself. You have come into this world, onto this earth, to imagine what it would be like to live in a state of separation. But deep within you is the knowing that you are not separate from any aspect of creation and can never be. So at the deepest level of your truth, you realize that your goal must be to overcome that which you have come here to experience. And that you shall do. The doing shall require of you that you be willing to challenge every value, every thought, every notion which you hold. Do not fear, rather rejoice, for your willingness shall be the doorway that opens unto love and joy and freedom. I tell you, as you open your being to this Course in Miracles, the barriers will dissolve and the world will take on new meaning. Your life will blossom and grow and expand into an eternity of immense joy, into a world of light, and into an unfathomable beauty of which I cannot speak. For truly, your minds cannot comprehend the measure of that which is your right and your inheritance as the Son of God. Blessings upon you all. That is all. Okay. So, this is a flavor. This is a flavor. Of a transmission. This is a transmission from Yeshua, Jesus Yeshua. It has some different emphasis than Longchenpa. Different emphasis a little bit, yeah. But it's the same, it's the same, it's the same. It points, you can feel the same adamancy, right? Slightly different verbiage, slightly different emphasis. And of course, depending on what we feel most comfortable with, we will feel a little bit uneasy or consternation. Like, how come these words are like this or that? And you just do the full stop in that burn. There's no teaching necessarily with words that's really going to be satisfied entirely. If you keep looking for, okay, I need to find something that's perfectly suited for me, you're probably never going to find that. Longchenpa's works are set in the Tibetan culture a little bit, the Buddhist culture a little bit, in reference to certain Buddhist words that I don't really quite understand, and in various traditions and things and so. But just let that flow, just let the meaning flow through you. Don't get stuck on any words. And of course, the emphasis that I have seen on the continuity fear, on wanting to be greater than God, on desiring contrast. Jesus calls it being in conflict. Yeah, when you're trying to defeat something, there's conflict, right? Yeah. So the emphasis that I feel most comfortable with is a little different than Yeshua, a little different than Longchenpa. Okay. And yours will be a little different from everybody. What's important is to continue getting your familiar, comfortable. And eventually we go beyond the words of it, where we see it entirely and we don't need the words anymore. Though there will always be some discomfort with words, because words are entirely arbitrary, actually. They depend on our willingness to accept the meaning that the speaker is implying, and even then we're guessing. So it's really kind of guesswork. We have to sort of guess, and what are they implying here? What are they implying? What I get from what Jesus just said is that the way that we're all one, and the way it is in our freedom, in our perfect freedom, he says, don't judge anyone about what they want, what they're experiencing is. Don't bind anyone to the way that you want to see them. See, everyone is absolutely free. Which is the truth. And to know that everyone is absolutely free, this is what Jesus is pointing about. This is his way. He speaks to interpersonal, his teachings is more interpersonal as far as how you're judging your brother, your one another, like that, and binding them as you set them free, so you set yourself free. But ultimately, it only makes sense in perfect, pure freedom. Otherwise, it doesn't make any sense. So, you have to understand, you know, the adamantness of the teaching. Otherwise, it will fail. But he made it very clear. He makes it very clear there, right? If you take it academically, you will fail and miss it entirely. See, very strong. The non-dual teachings only sound reasonable when you can intuitively accept what it is that they're pointing to as the goal. It's completely radical. Radical Dzogchen. You know, Jesus' teachings are completely radical. Radical Christianity. Everything without exception is totally unbound, is totally free. And from that perspective, the teachings are completely reasonable, but only from that perspective. So you cannot put new wine into old wineskins. You cannot get this absolute teaching and put it into non-absolute and expect it to fit. If you try to do that, you will end up watering down the teachings. Watering down the teachings, watering down, which is what's happened, of course, in Christianity, in all traditions. It happens. So what the problem is, words are inherently ambiguous. What I found is in reading through Longchenpa's all the way through, that is how I got the full sense of transmission. Like, okay, yes, I totally acknowledge that this is a transmission, a true transmission. When I was reading bits and pieces of it, I wasn't so sure. I said, well, I don't know. Maybe he says something different later on or something. I'm not sure. But when you read the whole thing through, then you get this impression. Oh, wow. You know, he really means what he's saying. And this really is the same thing with Yeshua's work, Jesus's work. Just reading the introduction, I've got this feeling like, I need some further, you know, clarification here, right? Some of the traditions, the high traditions, used small books where you could read through the entire teaching in one sitting. And I feel that this is very helpful, actually. Rather than studying a book bit by bit by bit by bit by bit, that's a step along the way. That's a step along the way. Now, this book is a little too much to read through in one sitting. It's 358 pages. I don't know if I'll try it or not, but maybe it's too much. A Course in Miracles is too much to do through in one sitting. So that's why I call this phase 1, 2, 3. The Bible's too much to do in one sitting. Actually, I tried to do it. I sat down once and read through the entire Bible from beginning to end. It took me almost a week or something, but it was nonstop effort. Get up in the morning, start first thing, all the way to nighttime. Next day, exact same thing. I read through the whole thing like that. Yeah, I used to do that. Course in Miracles is the same situation. It's so many words. This is less words, you know. And so you can like gobble up chapters and get more of a total feeling of what's being said. But still, Longchenpa's, this one is doable. I just did it yesterday. Went through the entire thing in 2 hours. And I found that to be immensely beneficial. But of course, this is phase four. Phase four is to be able to get the whole thing. And by getting the whole thing, you're then able to set the whole thing down, so to speak, you know, the wordiness of it, right? Because there's not more words to get. You say, wow, I got all the words, and that's it. And I get what's being said now. So it's easy to see, like, the whole words are like a one package you can set down. Whereas if you're reading chapters and stop there, you think, well, I need to read the next chapter and the next chapter. And so it kind of sort of keeps you bound to the ambiguity of words. My feeling is that the most powerful kind of help is to sit quietly and have read to you the complete transmission, a complete transmission in one sitting. And I've also found that reading something aloud is profoundly more helpful than reading it quietly. It brings a greater sense of concentration. I know something about it that is much more helpful. If you just sit there studying by yourself quietly, reading this line, okay. But if you're having to speak it out loud, you kind of feel the feeling of it. And you have to express it, the feeling of it. And you know, it draws something, it deepens you. So I believe the best teaching is the silent sitting, full stop in the burn. Someone is reading a full transmission of truth. The whole thing, right there. And this is the fourth phase. This is the fourth phase. Now, this has been used in other times and places as the fourth phase in their various traditions. This, I believe, does happen. And this is very advanced teaching. It's what works. It's what works. I may do it with this, I don't know, but it can't be done in one sitting is the problem with A Journey Beyond Words. It can't be done in one sitting. I believe it's very important. That's why I've often said like a couple hours is necessary in your practice, to give a couple hours of concentrated listening where you feel you've got the flavor of the entire transmission. It's all there. And then you rest in the full stop in the burn, just quiet. You've got it all. This is phase four, and we're getting into phase four now. So, in my experience, this spaciousness, this book lends itself to phase four better than Journey Beyond Words. It does. But, as I have said, phase one is a bridge to phase two. Phase two is a bridge to phase three. Phase three is a bridge to phase four. Phase four is a bridge to phase five. Idea came to me is simply read this book every day. If we have some sort of meetings or whatever happens, just read it every day. It takes about 2 hours. If you did that every day, heard it being read out loud, and concentrated on that for 2 hours, and just in this burn, like, wow, this is very intense, this would bring about astonishing progress for you. Astonishing familiarity. And you would never regret it. You know, it is just fast track to liberation. Fast track to liberation. So I'm considering this as a possibility. I have not had any transmission for me to write down. It's not really necessary. It seems that Longchenpa is like some ultimate wordsmith in terms of knowing what to put in and leave out. And to convey in such simple, direct terms. Now maybe Jesus will give a transmission which is even more condensed than Journey Beyond Words. We certainly, my feeling is, we need something more condensed. This is just my feeling in reading this. It's like, in phase four, we need to hear the whole picture presented to us within the time frame that we're spending. Very important, phase four. So, we will see. I'm giving thought, giving consideration to this. Because once you see it, all you need to do is see it again and again and again and again and again and get familiar with seeing it. That's it. You don't need to study it anymore. You don't need more words for it. It just again and again and again and again you need to return to seeing it. So you get familiar and comfortable with this complete recognition. Familiar and comfortable with this complete recognition. So I'm considering it. I'm really considering this. So logistically, how could that happen? In the great traditions, there would be like one prayer, a book, or something read over and over each day, over and over each day. You hear it again and again and again and again and again. Our priest is giving a seminar in Christian meditation. Which is the practice would be to hear this prayer every day. You hear this prayer every day, and it apparently sums up for them. But this is an example. for a small example, it's like the Lord's Prayer. This is an example. But I don't feel that that, you know, is the kind of summation, enough of a summation, that we truly get the feel of dropping duality entirely, you know. And it's possible. If you're so advanced, that's all you need. A short, you know, couple verses and that's it. That's like super advanced, yeah. You might need a little more elaboration than that, for sure. Because in non-duality, it's going towards choiceless awareness, so we don't really need to learn or progress, you know, like, okay, I got this, now what's the next progress? In other words, how can I triumph over my stupidity or something? No. So hearing it over and over again, the same truth, become more and more and more comfortable with it. And comfort, your comfort zone is what will succeed ultimately. It's not your intelligence, it's your comfort zone. There have been plenty of mystics in all traditions who simply recited the same prayers over and over and over and over and over again because somehow that summed it up for them, okay? And they had developed such a comfort zone with it, they entered into the choiceless awareness. Their attention relaxed into that choiceless awareness, yes. And we can do exactly the same, exactly the same. There's nothing stopping us, actually. So we'll see what the situation is disposed towards here, and then we'll find out. Okay, very great, that's it.